Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. In this video, I'll be explaining you about centrifugal pumps, their working, heads and efficiencies. Okay, so coming to the definition of centrifugal pumps. Centrifugal pumps are the hydraulic machines which convert mechanical energy to hydraulic energy. Okay, if you remember turbines are also hydraulic machines. They convert hydraulic energy to mechanical energy. Okay, so pumps are just the reverse of turbines. And in pumps you have two types. You have centrifugal pumps as well as reciprocating pumps. So in this video I'll be particularly explaining you about centrifugal pumps, and after the completion of centrifugal pumps we will go on with reciprocating pumps. Okay, centrifugal pumps work on the principle of forced vortex flow, where there is a centrifugal force involved, whereas reciprocating pumps works on the principle of reciprocating action. Okay, so now for the next couple of videos we'll be covering all the points related to centrifugal pumps, then we'll go with reciprocating pumps. So coming to centrifugal pump, as I've told you, it works on the principle of forced vortex flow. So what is the meaning of this forced vortex flow? It means that if you consider any mass of liquid, okay, just take little bit amount of liquid and you rotate it with the help of a torque. You know torque, right? Torque is the force which rotates the object. So if you give the torque to that liquid, slowly the pressure head of the liquid takes place. Nothing but the slowly rise in the pressure of the liquid takes place. How is this pressure rise happening? I have certain mass of liquid and I'm giving a torque. Torque is what? Force into radius. So when I'm giving a force into for this mass of liquid, how is the level of liquid rising? Yes, it is due to the conversion of this mechanical energy into pressure energy by means of a centrifugal force. As I've told you, torque is nothing but force into radius. Nothing but the force that is acting there is called as a centrifugal force. This centrifugal force will make the mass of liquid to rotate and rise. This centrifugal force converts this mechanical energy into pressure energy. So once the water gains pressure, it starts rising up. And that's how we can deliver the water to any heights. Okay, this is, since you are involving centrifugal force, it is so called centrifugal pump. So this is the principle behind the working of a centrifugal pump. Hope you are clear. It is raising of the liquid when it is rotated by an external torque which involves a centrifugal force. This centrifugal force converts the mechanical energy of the water to pressure energy. Okay, and this pressure energy helps it moving the liquid to higher levels. Okay, and centrifugal pump always acts as a reverse of an inward radial flow reaction turbine. If you are aware of inward radial flow reaction turbine, the best example of this is a Francis turbine. Okay, so in a reaction turbine you have both pressure energy and kinetic energy to be considered. Inward radial flow means the water enters axially and leaves out radially. Okay, but centrifugal pump is reverse of that. Means what? The water enters the centrifugal pumps in a radial manner and they exit in a axial manner. Okay, remember, in a centrifugal pump the water enters in a radial manner. Okay, which means it's the reverse of inward radial flow reaction turbine. So see this diagram. As I've told you, you have a certain mass of liquid which is subjected to an external torque. So what will happen? The torque makes the water to rotate, correct? So like this, slowly the force will make the water to rotate, and during this rotation the mechanical energy of the water will be slowly converted into pressure energy and will make the water to rise. Okay, coming to the parts of a centrifugal pump, we have four important components of a centrifugal pump. They are impeller. Impeller is nothing but the rotating part of your pump. Okay, whatever might be the type of the pump, the rotating part of a pump is called impeller. You have the rotating part of a turbine, right? The rotating part of a turbine is called as runner, and the rotating part of a centrifugal pump is called impeller. This impeller will have vanes or buckets fitted inside. Next is the casing. Casing is the cover, protective cover all along the impeller. Next, you have a suction pipe with a foot valve and a strainer, and you have a delivery pipe. So I'll show you this components in diagram. Yeah, see this diagram. This is your impeller, right? This complete setup, this circle you have, right, with these vanes, that is called as the impeller, and the center part is called as the eye of the impeller. And as I've told you, around the impeller you have a casing of gradually increasing area. Next, you have a suction pipe. See here, what is the suction pipe? This suction pipe is connected from the center of the impeller to the water sump or the sump tank. You generally have sump tank, right, below the ground level. So from there to the impeller it connects, that is called as a suction pipe. So water will enter through the suction pipe from the sump tank to the impeller. Next, you have a delivery pipe. See here, what is this delivery pipe? Whatever the water has entered the impeller and the casing, that will be taken by the delivery pipe to the required height. So this delivery pipe will be connected from the center of the impeller to the overhead tank, wherever it has to be disposed. Okay, next you have foot valve and a strainer. You have a foot valve, right? At the end of the suction pipe, you have a foot valve. So this foot valve will open upwards so that water starts entering into the foot valve. And you have a strainer here. This strainer is provided to arrest any particulate matter, like any dust or any matter you throw, or it accidentally falls into the water, it will not enter into the pipe. So you put a strainer here. Okay, and coming to this is your suction valve and this is your delivery valve. Okay, so the main components are four. One is impeller, next is the casing, next is the suction pipe with foot valve and strainer, and next is the delivery pipe. So see here, as I've told you, the water enters into the impeller, it will into the impeller in a radial manner and it will come out. Okay, so you can observe in this diagram also. So the radial the water enters into the impeller radially and it will come out. So even this diagram also you can observe. This was taken from R.K. Bansal textbook. Okay, the same components which I have told you. Now coming to detailed explanation about the components. What was the first component I told you? It was impeller. The rotating part of a centrifugal pump is called impeller. It consists of a series of backward curved vanes. And see here in this diagram, any diagram you prefer. So this is the eye of the impeller, right? And you have vanes here, correct? Can you observe these lines? Yes, these are the vanes fitted on the impeller. Okay, and these vanes are curved backwards. Okay, you can observe, right? The curve is backward. And this impeller is mounted on a shaft which is connected to the shaft of an electric motor. So if you observe this diagram, you see this is your impeller part, correct? You see the pointer. This is the impeller part, and here you have the shaft of the motor. Okay, this is impeller. From the impeller you have shaft of the motor, from the shaft of the impeller, and here you have shaft of the motor. So both are connected. It means your shaft of the impeller and shaft of the motor are same or collinear. Means once you start the power supply, the shaft of this motor rotates. Means what? Your impeller is also rotating, correct? Then only the action is taking place. So your shaft of the impeller and shaft of the motor are same. Okay, so impeller is mounted on a shaft which is connected to the shaft of the electric motor. Most of the cases both of them will be mounted on the same shaft. Both of them means your electric motor and the impeller. Okay, or else they are joined together at least. Why? Because once you give the power supply for your motor, you switch on your motor, right? Once you switch on, what will happen? Your motor starts rotating. Means what? The shaft of your motor is rotating. Means what? Your impeller also should rotate. So when motor shaft is rotating, which implies impeller is also rotating, means what? They should be on the same shaft. Then only both can rotate simultaneously. Next, coming to casing. As I've told you here, You can see this is a casing, right? This is an airtight passage. You should by any means, air should not enter inside this casing. If air enters inside this casing, you have the problem of water not delivering out. So for this, you have to do priming. Generally, you do priming, right? Why? Because to remove out the air bubbles. So see that the casing is always airtight. If by any means air is entering inside the casing, the energy conversion will not be proper, and hence the water will not be delivered properly. Even though your motor is running, your water will not come out. Have you observed it any time? That's due to entering of air bubbles into the casing. So you have to see that this no air bubble is entering inside the casing, and the casing also will be designed in such a way that air will not enter. Okay, and you can observe the area of the casing is increasing gradually. Okay, so see, now the water is entering like this into the impeller, and slowly it will come out like this and like this, correct? Water is entering from the sump tank through the suction pipe into this impeller, and since they are backward curved vanes, it will come out like this. So when it is coming out like this, see, area is increasing gradually. When area is increasing, velocity will reduce. When velocity will reduce, pressure will increase. So the water will come out with high pressure like this. That is why the casing is designed as a spiral casing. And I have told you, mechanical energy is getting converted into pressure energy, right? This happens inside the casing itself. So indirectly we can say casing is performing this action. Okay, it is designed in such a way that kinetic energy is converted into pressure energy before leaving and entering the delivery pipe, as I've told. So coming to casing, we have basically three types of casing: volute casing, vortex casing, and casing with guide plates. So see here, whatever casing I observed in this diagram is a volute casing. Okay, see, volute casing means it's a spiral type of casing in which area of flow is increasing gradually. As I've shown you, once water comes out from the impeller, it will travel in this fashion, and you can see the arrow marks. So as you're seeing this direction, the area is increasing gradually, correct? Means decreasing the velocity. Decreasing in velocity means increasing in pressure. So most of the times we use volute casing only, but the problem with volute casing is formation of eddies will take place. So which may slightly vary your efficiency, and that's the only disadvantage we have with a volute casing. Okay, so if you can see the components of a volute casing, this is the impeller, this is the spiral casing or a volute casing, this is the eye of the impeller, as I've told you already, this is the shaft to which your impeller is fitted, and these are the vanes of your impeller or your blades of your impeller, and this is the volute chamber. Next, coming to vortex casing, as I've told you earlier, there is a formation of eddies taking place, right? So to reduce, what will happen if eddies formation takes place? Your pressure energy will reduce. Okay, so but we require high pressure, right, to deliver our water to greater heights. So once your pressure decreases, the water will deliver slowly. Hence we have to see that this eddies formation is minimized. So for that, what you can do, you can prefer vortex casing. In this vortex casing, what will happen, we introduce a circular chamber in between the casing and the impeller, okay, as shown in the figure. See here, you have this impeller and you have a casing, and in between you have the dotted lines, right? That's a circular chamber. So this can minimize your formation of eddies. And the third one is the casing with guide blade. Guide blades or guide vanes, if you remember this, the same guide vane mechanism is provided for reaction turbines. You can observe these guide vanes in Francis turbine and a Kaplan turbine. Why? Because we consider both pressure energy and kinetic energy. So in order to reduce the pressure, or since the water will strike with high pressure, the blades may get damaged and they may subjected to shock. To arrest that, we provide a guide vane mechanism, right? Similarly, here also, in this type of casing also, we have guide blades. Okay, see this outer, see now, this exactly where my pointer is there, that's your eye of the impeller, that's the shaft, this outer circle, you can find this first arrow mark, right? This is the eye of the impeller, this complete setup is your impeller, okay? And around you have another ring, right? See this outer ring with vanes, right? These veins, see where my pointer is there. These veins are called guide veins, and this outer ring or circle on which these guide veins are fixed is known as a diffuser. Okay, and even it is designed such that as the water enters like this, it will travel, it will go into the guide veins and it will come out into the chamber and it will leave out. So what will happen? Even with the help of guide veins, slowly we are trying to reduce the velocity of water. Consequently, we are increasing the pressure of water. Okay, and we have to see that this ring or the diffuser, whatever you have kept, will be concentric with the shaft or the impeller. Concentric means they have, all of them have the same center. Okay, the impeller and the diffuser will have the same center. Okay, you can observe the guide vanes also are curved backwards. This is about casing with guide blades. So we have totally three types of casing: volute casing, vortex casing, and casing with guide blades. Okay, coming to the third component, suction pipe with a foot valve and a strainer. I have told you already, we have a, yeah, if you observe this diagram, yeah, we have a foot valve and a strainer here. So foot valve will open in upward direction. The water will start sucking inside, right, into the suction pipe. So it will open in the upward direction, and a strainer is fitted exactly at the foot valve itself, so that any dust matter or any particle matter, any matter or suspended matter also can be arrested here. Okay. And next, coming to the last one, delivery pipe. So delivery pipe is fitted from the outlet of the pump, nothing but from the impeller, right? From the impeller. This impeller is outlet of the pump means outlet of the impeller only. Okay. So from here to the delivery pipe is started, the connection to where you want to deliver, till there the pipe will continue. This is how are the components. Are you clear with the components? We have totally four. First one is impeller, the rotating part of the centrifugal pump. Next we have casing, and next we have suction valve with a foot valve and a strainer, suction pipe, sorry. And fourth one is the delivery pipe. Next, coming to the heads of a centrifugal pump. Okay, I'll again open the same diagram. Yeah, see this diagram. First head is suction head. Okay, we have totally three heads mainly, and other one will be a fourth head, but mostly we require three heads for our calculation purposes, but to study we have four. So first I'll tell you what are the three main components, three main heads. Okay, first one is a suction head. See here, I have denoted with HS. Suction head is nothing but, it is the head from the water surface in the sump tank to the center of the impeller. Center of the impeller or center of the pump. I repeat, it is the height of water or height from the surface of the sump tank to the center of the impeller. Okay. Next is delivery head. Delivery head is height from the center of the impeller to the surface of water where the water has delivered. I repeat, delivery head is the distance between or the height between the center of the impeller to the surface where the water has delivered. Okay, that is delivery head. This is suction head. Next you have static head. Static head is a summation of delivery head and suction head. Right, see here. This is what I've explained you already. So static head is summation of delivery head and suction head. Next comes manometric head. It is defined as the head against which a centrifugal pump has to work. So what does this mean? It is the total summation of all the heads. You have delivery head, you have suction head, you have head losses. See, now water is entering into the suction pipe, right? Means what? Whatever water is entering into the suction pipe will not fall on the impeller. Why? Why? Because due to friction, some of the water bubbles will get stuck to your suction pipe, which means there is a head loss. Then the water is entering into the impeller in the casing, the water is rotating, energy conversion is taking place. Again, the water is leaving out to the delivery pipe. From the delivery pipe, the water is falling in the overhead tank. Now, whatever water is coming out from the outlet of the impeller is traveling into the delivery pipe and falling into the overhead tank. But tell, is the total amount of water, whatever is traveling from the delivery pipe, reaching the overhead tank? No. Why? Because again, due to friction, some of the water in the delivery pipe will get stuck up. So means what? Again, we are losing some head in the delivery pipe. So due to friction, we are losing head in the delivery pipe. Due to friction, we are losing head in the suction pipe. Due to friction, we may lose some head near the impeller also. Impeller is fitted with blades, so the water may struck on the blades also. Correct? So the summation of all these heads is called as manometric head. So indirectly, we tell that the head against which the pump is working is called as a manometric head. So this is given by HS suction head plus HD delivery head plus HFS means what? Frictional head loss in the suction pipe plus HFD means frictional head loss in the delivery pipe plus VD square by 2G. This is velocity of water. This is a velocity head actually, where VD is the velocity of water in the delivery pipe. Okay, this is how you have to define manometric head. So I clear with the four heads: suction head, delivery head, static head and manometric head. Next, coming to work done by the impeller of the pump on the water. So in generally, we calculate work done by drawing velocity triangles. We have calculated work done in turbines also, correct? We draw velocity triangles at the inlet and outlet of the vane or the bucket, okay? Then we solve for work done per second. So now see here, this is how the velocity triangles are drawn for impeller. Now just see, observe carefully. Where I have put the pointer, this is the eye of the impeller, okay? And you can see, this is the complete round circle. If you remember this diagram, yeah, this is the eye of the impeller, what I have shown you. You observe this circle, this first circle and the second curve. The same curve is this. Okay, this is the eye of the impeller, this is the first curve, this is the second curve. So like this, the total impeller will be there. And you have a curved vane, right? On this backward curved vane, you can observe, right? The curve is on the back side of the vane. So this is the vane. Now what is happening? Water is entering like this radially. So it will slash or strike the bucket like this. Okay, you observe V1, right? V1 stands for velocity of water or jet striking the vane. So it will strike like this. It will glide all along the curve and it will leave like this. Okay? So as we have drawn velocity triangles for turbine, in the same fashion we will be drawing velocity triangles here. But the only, so this will be the velocity triangle at the inlet, this will be the velocity triangle at the outlet. The only correction here to be made is, as I've told you, centrifugal pump, water is entering radially. So when water is entering radially, your alpha becomes 90 degrees. So what is alpha? It is the vane angle at the inlet. Okay, alpha becomes 90 degrees and hence your VW1 becomes 0. Okay, you remember, if for any clarification, you can just go back to your turbines and open the velocity triangles. I will not explain this again and again. So just see how we have drawn velocity triangles, where we have marked VW1, where we marked alpha. Okay, alpha is your vane angle. So how we have marked those values. Just have a look. So your alpha is the vane angle at the inlet, which is nothing but the angle between the absolute velocity V1 and the tangential velocity U1. Correct? See here, you can observe V1 and U1. If you draw velocity triangles, if you remember velocity triangles, which we draw in impact of jet, there it will be inclined. Okay? And once you resolute the alpha, you will be getting VW1, which will be the horizontal distance. But since here alpha became 90 degrees, we don't have a question of VW1. That's how VW1 becomes 0. Okay? So just before going to through this work done, just refer impact of jet on vanes topic. There especially work done or force exerted by on an unsymmetrical moving plate. Just take that reference and then you will understand this very easily. Okay? Once again, I'm repeating, force exerted on an unsymmetrical moving curved plate. Just refer to that topic and you come back here. So here, since the water is entering radially into the pump, what is happening? Alpha becomes 90 degrees, that is the vane angle at the inlet, and hence VW1 becomes 0. So, as I've told you, the expression of work done by the impeller on the water is obtained by drawing velocity triangles at inlet and outlet, as I've said you. Then, the water is entering radially at the inlet means water makes an angle of 90 degrees. Sorry, this is not this. This is 90 degrees. with the direction of motion, which means alpha is 90 degrees, which means VW1 is 0. So, as I've told you, centrifugal pump is the reverse of an inward flow reaction turbine, correct? If you remember inward flow reaction turbine, what did we do is, we put beta as 90 degrees and we put VW2 to 0. Okay, why? Because water is leaving out radially. Here water is entering radially, so alpha became 90 and VW1 became 90. So, work done by the impeller on the water is equal to minus of work done in case of turbine. See, listen carefully, why I am putting a minus is, if you take the concept of turbine, there work is done by the water on the turbine. Okay, I am repeating, listen carefully. If you take turbines, there work is done by the water on the turbine. Why? Because water is making the turbine to rotate, correct? So water is the one which is making work there. So we are calculating work done by the water on the turbine. Come back to pump now. But what is happening in the pump? Impeller is rotating, correct? Impeller is rotating. It is converting the energy and it is sucking the water from the suction tank, from the suction pipe, from the sump tank. So what is work doing, what is the component which is doing work here? Impeller. Impeller is rotating and sucking the water. Okay. So what should we calculate? Work done by the impeller on the water. Okay. You have to see who is the main object here. In case of turbines, water is the main object. Once water falls on the turbine only, then only work done can take place. So that's why there we are calculating work done by the water on the turbine. But you come back to impeller, what is happening? Impeller should rotate first. See, once you just imagine practically what happens once you switch on the motor, your mother says, please switch on the motor. Once you switch on the motor, what will happen? Your motor starts rotating. Motor starts rotating means what? I have told you just a couple of minutes back. The shaft of the motor and the shaft of the impeller are same. Means what? Once the motor is rotating, impeller is also rotating. So who is rotating first? Impeller. Who is doing work first? Impeller. Then only the water is coming from the suction pipe, from the sump tank. So here we will be calculating work done by the impeller on the water. This is how you need to have a clarity. Minus of work done in case of turbine means, in turbine what I am doing? I am doing the reverse, no? I am calculating work done by the water on turbine. So just to reverse this, I have put a negative sign. So this is minus of, this formula is already dealt to you, VW1 U1 minus VW2 U2 by G. This is work done per second per unit weight. Okay, and as I've told you, if you just multiply minus inside, you'll be getting this formula. Since VW1 is 0, this complete term becomes 0. So you'll be left with VW U2 by G. This formula is for work done by the impeller on the water per second per unit weight. Per unit weight of water. So from there, if you just want to calculate work done by the impeller on the water per second, it will be weight into this formula. Okay, I'm repeating, work done by the impeller on the water per second per unit weight means divide work done by unit weight is equal to this value. If I want only work done, it will be unit weight into this value, which is W into VW2 U2 by G. So remember both the formulas. We can apply, depending upon the question, we should apply either this. So this formula you should apply when it is per unit weight. This formula is only per second. Okay. And from where W is what? Weight of water, which is given by the formula rho into G into Q. This formula came from, if you remember the formula of specific weight is equal to weight by volume, correct? So from there, weight is equal to specific weight into volume. Specific weight is rho G. So rho G into volume. Since I'm calculating work weight per second, it will be rho G into volume per second. Volume can be written as area into one of the dimension. So area into length by second, I'll write. So what will happen? Length by second will be velocity. So I'll be left with weight per second is equal to rho into g into area into velocity. Area into velocity can be written as q. So like this, you'll get the formula of rho g q. And q will be pi by 4 d square into v you can do, or else width is given especially. Then you have to take this formula. Pi d1 b1 into vf1. Vf1 is what? Flow velocity. Which is equal to pi d2 b2 into vf2. Any of the formulas you can use. Coming to the efficiencies of the centrifugal pump, right? In case of, right, before defining efficiencies of centrifugal pump, you have to just have an idea of the phenomenon, what is taking place to write the efficiencies. See, first what is happening, as I've told you, just imagine now practically, now your mother told, just put on the motor, okay? Since you want to deliver the water to your overhead tank, which is on the upstairs, your mother asked, just put on the motor. What is happening? You just switched on the switch. Once you on the switch, what is happening? Electricity is a main factor, correct? You are putting the switch on means what? There is electricity, means power. Indirectly we call it power or electrical power. That power will be transmitted from the shaft of the motor to the shaft of the pump. Correct? That I've told you, right? And on the shaft of the pump, what is there? Impeller is there. Then what is this impeller doing? It is giving this mechanical energy to the water. Correct? So what is this water doing? It is taking the mechanical energy, and this casing is converting this mechanical energy to pressure energy, and it is moving out from the impeller to the delivery pipe. So what are the three main steps here? One is shaft of the motor, shaft of the pump or the impeller is the same. So I'll take only one step there. First step is shaft of the motor, then impeller, then water delivered. Correct? First step is shaft of the motor. Okay, where I'm getting the electricity. What is motor doing? What is the purpose of a motor? Motor will convert electrical energy into mechanical energy. So motor took electrical energy. When you switched on, motor took this electrical energy, it converted into mechanical energy. And it gave this mechanical energy to whom? Pump. What is the purpose of the pump? Pump will convert mechanical energy to hydraulic energy. So what this pump did? It gave this mechanical energy to the impeller. Impeller started rotating. Impeller converted mechanical energy to hydraulic energy. So finally, what is the first input of this total operation? Electrical energy. Indirectly, we call this as shaft power or power available at the shaft of the electrical motor. Next, what is the intermediate step? Impeller. What is happening near the impeller? Energy is getting converted from electrical from mechanical to pressure. Then comes water, which is delivered. So basically we have three components. One is shaft power, then you have power at the impeller, then you have water delivered. Now according to this, we will define the efficiencies. We have three types: manometric efficiency, mechanical efficiency, and overall efficiency. See the definition of manometric efficiency: the ratio of power given to water at the outlet of the pump to the power available at the impeller is known as manometric efficiency. So it is defined as the ratio of power at the outlet of the pump by the power available at the impeller. Means, as I've told you, in these three steps, what was the first step? Okay, it is shaft power. Second step is impeller. So on the impeller, what is happening? Mechanical energy is coming and falling at the impeller. So impeller is rotating, and with the help of casing, it is converting the energy. Correct? So manometric efficiency means it is the power which is available at the impeller. Nothing but before conversion, what is the power? That will be its input. And after conversion, what is the power? That will be the output. So efficiency means output by input. So manometric efficiency means power at the outlet of the impeller or outlet of the pump by power at the inlet of the pump or impeller. Okay, and this is given by the formula G into HM by VW2. How you got this formula means, what is power at the outlet of the pump? Work done by the impeller. Just now we calculated the formula VW2 U2 by G. By power available at the impeller is HM. Sorry, power available at the impeller is work done. Power at the outlet of the pump means what? After working, what is happening? What is getting delivered, right? So it is nothing but HM. So HM by VW2 U2 by G. VW2 U2 by G is power available at the impeller, which is nothing but the work done by the impeller. Just now we have derived that value. So from there you get the manometric efficiency. So I'm repeating, manometric efficiency is the ratio of power at the outlet of the impeller by power at the inlet of the impeller. Mechanical efficiency is the second one. It is the ratio of power available at the impeller to the power available at the shaft, right? Now I told you, right, from the shaft, the energy is coming, electrical energy is coming to the pump. So he is telling, now consider that part. That is mechanical efficiency means it is power available at the inlet of the impeller divided by the shaft power. So how much actual electrical energy came, how much actual power came to how much it got transmitted to the impeller. That's your mechanical efficiency. And it is given by this formula. Power available at the inlet is nothing but the inlet of the impeller is nothing but the work done by the impeller. So the same formula which I have taught you just now, my power at the shaft is nothing but shaft power. The shaft power is nothing but when you put on the switch, how much electricity is coming. That is this. Next is overall efficiency. Now in this complete operation, what is the overall output? You switched on the motor, something happened. What is the overall output? Water delivered into your tank, right? That's the overall output. By what is the overall input? You switched on the motor, means shaft power. That's all is the overall efficiency. It is the ratio of output of the pump to input of the pump. Output of the pump is WHM by 1000. This I have told you. W is weight of the water lifted into manometric head. By 1000 I'm dividing to get in kilowatts. So WHM by 1000. Manometric head, you remember? Summation of all heads. Yeah. By power input is what? Shaft power. What you supplied with the help of a motor. Correct? So that's eta naught, which is overall output by overall input, which is WHM by SP into 1000. So, and we have a relation, overall efficiency is manometric efficiency into mechanical efficiency. Clear? So, once again, I'm repeating efficiencies. We have three basic steps here. One is giving power supply to the motor, which is called shaft power. Next, you have impeller. Next, you have water delivered. So, if you take the first set, which is nothing but shaft power and impeller, there comes mechanical efficiency. Okay, if you take that two sets, now you just can see. I'll take a pencil. Oh, sorry, I take a pen. So what I've told you, you have shaft power, which is nothing but your motor. Next, you have a impeller. Sorry, please ignore the bad handwriting. And you have water, which is delivered. Okay, now see this operation. This set I'm telling. Consider this set. Shaft power. Means what? The power given by the motor. Means once you on the switch, this is what comes. And this is impeller. Correct? So if you consider this set, here comes mechanical efficiency. Power available at the impeller by the power at the shaft. So in this set, this is output, this is input, and this is how eta m comes. Next, if you consider overall efficiency, overall output of the cycle and overall input of the cycle. What is overall output of the cycle? Water getting delivered. By what is overall input of the cycle? Shaft power. Next is manometric efficiency. Ratio of power given to water at the outlet to the power available. So near the impeller, what is happening? Energy conversion is taking place. So once the power which is coming into the impeller, that will be its input. And after conversion, it is going out, right? The delivery pipe, that will be the output. So just output by input will give you the manometric efficiency. Okay, this is how you need to learn the things, and it will be a little bit difficult where you are doing mainly efficiencies. So just read it properly once again, go through the video once again, and read the matter what I have placed in the presentation. I have given a detailed matter, so just go through it once again and try to understand the things. Still, if you have any doubt, you can just comment me and I'll clear your doubts. Okay, and I have an important thing to tell you. In the next video of mine, I'll be solving few problems related to efficiencies, okay, regarding velocity triangles, work done, how to calculate the missing parameters, how to calculate efficiencies and all. I'll be posting this in my next video. So please make sure you watch the video. Why? Because we are doing problems related to this, which are very important from exam point of view. Okay, please don't miss out that video. I hope you understood, and thank you.